And then I'm not calling my dog. This dog clicker helps us synchronize up the audio.
Okay.
I am here in on Conlon Street with Roy Zuppardo of Zuppardo's Economical Grocery in Metairie. It is July 14th, 2010. We're doing an interview about the Zuppardo family and the food business in Italian New Orleans. Thanks for allowing me to interview today.
Thank you for having me.
Well, glad to be here. Let's talk a little bit about there was an interview done by Joe Maselli 30 years ago with your father.
Was it my dad or was it my uncle?
Oh, maybe it was your uncle. It was Joe Zuppardo.
Well, that had to be my father, yes.
Yeah, that was your father. I thought I'd kind of fettered. The first thing was confirm the genealogy. And he told us a lot of family stories, but what family stories do you remember him telling, particularly the early days, Italy, coming to America, and just getting started, your grandfather's stories, I guess?
Well, my grandfather came over in the early 1900s, and it was a tough time for everyone, naturally, coming to a new country, no job, no prospects of anything at that particular point. Wound up working for a company loading bananas off of boats, and wound up eventually buying that company. But started at the bottom and worked his way through the top. There's a million stories that I've heard. You'd have to ask me specific questions to get those. But you know, that was the start of our family business. And what had happened at that point was he went from managing the banana company to actually owning it. And naturally, his sons would go sell bananas in the neighborhood. And that started the fruit stand on Gentilly and Elysian Fields for the Zuppardo family, and turned in from a small little fruit stand on the back of a truck to a building, to the grocery store that was there for over 75 years. And now out here in Metairie, we have our store at 5010 Veterans Boulevard.
Yeah. One of the people that your father mentioned way back when was Luca. He called him Lukey Vaccaro. And do you know much about
him? No, I do not. I do not know him.
Because of course they're giants. They would start the Standard Fruit Company and all that. But you said that your grandfather started the largest banana business in the United States before World War II.
Yeah, I've heard that. I wasn't around, so I can't answer that or speak directly to that. But yes, I heard he did very well.
So I'm guessing Lawrence Orlando would not be would that be a name you'd recognize?
Yes, I do. Actually, Mr. Lawrence Orlando, who was the same age as my grandfather, we would see him every Sunday, or was it Sunday or Saturday evening? They would come to my grandmother's house, and the men would play cards, the women would do other stuff, and the kids were in the way. We were actually shoved out of the way most of the time when the conversations got good. We were told to leave.
Seen and not heard.
Yes, exactly.
Lawrence Orlando apparently is one of those it said that came over from Campo Reale, right?
Yes.
Do you know any of the Ippolito family?
Well, one of my aunts two of my aunts married two Ippolito brothers. So two Zuppardo girls married two Ippolito brothers. And yes, of course, they're my first cousins. The older generation, Leon Ippolito, was my godfather. Joe Ippolito was an uncle. And we all lived in the same neighborhood. One thing that we did do, my grandfather would not misspend a nickel. Anytime he had any money saved, he'd go buy a house. And he'd buy a house in his area. And so he'd put his kids there. So everybody lived on the same block. And it was a great way to grow up. It was a community of Italians and Zuppardos and family and cousins. And we all lived in a 2 or 3 block area.
Were a lot of these people in the food business?
The Ippolitos were. They did farming, and they did some. They would have what we called I remember them being called the country route, where they went out to places in Gonzales and Baton Rouge was the country, and you know those areas. And they would have customers that they called on. I guess you would liken it to a brokerage business 15 years ago. People might be able to relate to that the same way, where a broker would have 10 or 12 different items that he would peddle to different areas, and that's what the Ippolitos did. Now, Leon Ippolito wound up working, as I recall, and this, I'm a lot younger than I might appear, but he worked at our grocery store for quite some time too. So we got to see everybody worked at the grocery store at one point. My father-in-law worked at my grocery store before I married his daughter. So.
And tell me about your wife.
My wife is a Pharaoh. I still tell people, even though this is modern day America, that my parents picked my wife for me. And in fact, they did, and they did a great job. We've been married 38 years now, and thank goodness we still get along. My mother insisted that I go out with this young lady because she knew the family, and I absolutely had no desire to go out with someone that my mother picked out, as no one would. I mean, I had a girlfriend, and you know, I was in college, and I just didn't have time to be bothered with someone that my mother wanted me to go out with. But in fact, they persisted, and I'll never forget. I used to make $30 a week working in a grocery store full-time after college. I mean, I used to put in 40, 50 hours a week sometimes. And my dad used to give me 30 bucks a week. And I was going out with the Pharaoh girl, and he goes, "Oh, you going out with the Pharaoh girl?" Yeah. He goes, "Wait, where you going?" I said, "Well, I'm going to take her to dinner or something." He goes, "You take her someplace nice," and he handed me $100, which was 3 weeks of work for me. I went, whoa. So I was thrilled to go out with the Pharaoh girl. So I made it a point to go out with the Pharaoh girl as often as I thought I could get $100 from him, and it turned into a great love affair.
And you knew the Pharaohs through food, right?
Yes, actually, the Pharaohs, Jack Pharaoh was my wife's father. I never did meet Jack Pharaoh. He passed before I got the opportunity to meet him, but they had a little grocery store in uptown New Orleans, and his brothers had another grocery store right around Loyola University, which recently was closed, Pharaoh's supermarket there. My wife's family owned Rendon Quality Superette on Rendon Street, and the Pharaohs owned Pharaoh's supermarket. The other side of the family owned the Pharaoh's supermarket on Loyola, I believe.
Yeah, it's everybody's connected.
Yes.
In the world.
And her brother wound up being a food broker representing different lines of food for a good 20 to 30 years after that. So the food business has been in our family for quite some time.
And it seems to inform quite a lot, too.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And going over the old interview, one of the stories they tell is how they started Economical Grocery. Can you tell me, do you know the story about how they started Economical Grocery? At the original location in the 30s.
Well, basically, it started as the fruit stand. And, you know, my uncle used to always tell me, and my uncle was the one that started it before the war. When my father got back from World War II, it wasn't like, okay, we got to sign these documents, I'm going to sell you. It was like, come on, let's go to work, you know. And at the end of the day, there was, you know, $5 or $2 or whatever it was. Everybody split the money, and that was it. You go home, start over the next day. So my uncle actually took my father in and made him a partner in the business. So that was, my father didn't come in until late 40s, you know, after the war.
That area was a lot different back then, wasn't it?
The area has been through numerous changes, yes. Gentilly was rural in the beginning, and then it became densely populated, mostly typical American suburban type housing set up there, and today typical urban style housing today. So,
yeah. In the interview, they're saying that the old Jewish cemetery
across the street from where we were, that was there. Used to actually shouldn't say this on, but we used to go sneak in there and look at everything, you know, when we were younger, and that was a good place to go. And of course, I wouldn't go in at night; I was too scared. But it was fun growing up around that.
Do you have any fond memories of that old location in Chantilly?
Oh well, sure. We only gave it up after Katrina, and that was due to some issues with the city and getting the right zoning. The city was just, you know, they just didn't know which way to turn. Had no direction in which to go. No one was running. It was just there. It took us 9 months before they even got a chance to look at our plans to rebuild our Gentilly store, which we had already done years prior. And we submitted those plans and for their review. And you know, 9 months later, they said, "Okay, we're ready to talk to you. All you have to do is go to the city council, get it approved." By that time, Walgreens had made us an offer we couldn't refuse. So we wound up leasing the area to Walgreens.
Walgreens apparently is interested in a lot of the people I'm studying because Al Scaramuzza's place.
Yes, on Broad and St. Bernard. Is that where it was?
How did the song go? I forget.
Gosh, you know, my memory is getting worse with age.
Something too. About everything being pretty at Seafood City.
Yes. and you know, I can picture him on TV saying it, but I don't remember the jingle.
Did y'all know the Scaramuzzas?
Knew them basically because we lived a few blocks away from there, as we did the Kabibbies, who had the drugstore on the opposite corner from him. The Taraminas, which my mother was a Taramina, and the Udos. The Taraminas, my mother's family was the, they used to make spaghetti at the old chart house there. And then they were also a warehouse for food. The Udos wound up with Progresso Foods. They did Progresso Foods. So all of our cousins, we were all interrelated, all in the food industry. And everybody did everything with everyone. So we got to see all of these people and the beginnings of great companies. Progresso Foods was a major company that started here in New Orleans. I'm proud to say that, you know, I knew the guys that did it.
I was talking to Liz Bloom down at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum the other day, and she said they called Kraft, or I think, I guess they own Progresso now. And she's like, they didn't even seem to know that it had started in New Orleans, because they know Kraft is this big conglomerate.
Sure, no one knows. Yeah. But we know. We know down here, we know.
I'm going to start and stop this again.
Sure.
Somewhere my dog is saying, "Woof."
So how are we doing?
We're good. We're doing real good. I'll start that recording. Turn this on. Okay. Talk about the Taraminas a little bit. How much do you know about the Taramina family history? You say your mother was a Taramina.
My mother was a Taramina. I did meet my grandfather. I'm sorry. My mother's father passed away when I was about five. Never got to know him well. My grandmother lived to a nice old age. So I spent a lot of time at her house. She spent a lot of time with us. My two uncles, one passed away last year, Frank Taramina, and one passed away quite a few years back, Gene Taramina. And they were the two brothers that ran it after my grandfather was there. But my grandfather and his brother ran the initial pasta factory there for quite some time, and they did it together.
And the location of the pasta factory was?
Chart House now. Muriel's Restaurant today. Right next to the Cabildo and right there on the corner of Jackson Square. So it used to be a slave quarter prior to there, using it as a warehouse for making pasta and storing food.
Of course, that's legendary, you know, the Taramina location. Puglios, I always have trouble pronouncing Puglios. Your father identified them as somebody that they knew and liked and did a lot of business with. Do you know much about George Puglios?
Well, let's see. There were two Puglia families in the grocery business. One that I knew best, I thought was Frank, and I might be mistaken, but they were out in what you might call Araby today. I mean, it's definitely called Araby today. Puglia's. It's on the eastern side of Old Holy Cross High School location. That's the Puglia's that I knew, that my uncle and my dad knew real well. I don't know if we advertised together as a group at one point, but I do know that they were friends, and we would see them at functions outside of family functions.
I know, I feel like I'm going all over the place.
No, but that's all right. And then I think the George Puglia family had the grocery store in the French Quarter. Okay, and I'm not 100% sure of that, but I do know that they did very well, and they were in the food business for quite some time too.
Getting back to the grocery store, one of the things I mentioned was the Bell stores. And in the 1980, I mean, I'm ignorant of this, so in 1980, the Bell stores was still an active entity. Is that going today?
No. Although, I believe Durignac still uses the emblem of the Bell in some of their advertising, or maybe on their bags. I'm not 100% sure. I should know that. But yeah, the Bell Group was... We used to buy from a warehouse called P.A. Menard, and that warehouse was located on Claiborne Avenue in New Orleans, and it served independent stores like ourselves. And what they did was get a group of store owners, Natels, Zuppardo's, or Economical we were called at the time, Durignac's, Puglia's might have been part of that group, I'm not 100% sure, but there was a group of stores that got together under the P.A. Menard as the wholesaler, and they'd run specials. They decide, okay, look, we can buy a whole truckload of tomato sauce, Contadina tomato sauce, and sell it for a nickel a can, but we have to buy a whole truckload. How many cases can you take, and can we sell the whole truckload? Yes, we did. Okay, good. Then we'll run that in an ad for 5 cents a can or whatever the price was at the time. So that's what the Bell Group was. It was just a group that advertised today. That advertised in the paper when we advertised on a weekly basis, as they still do today. Every Thursday is Best Food Day in New Orleans, so our newspaper ad comes out every Thursday. And although we advertise independently, for years we still advertised in that group.
What big changes, if you had to identify a set of changes that since 1980 and your father gave an interview in the grocery business, what would they be, the biggest changes?
Delivery, how we procure, how we get our merchandise at this particular point has changed dramatically. We used to spend a lot of time purchasing direct from food companies like Kraft. Progresso would deliver to us no matter what. but some companies, Procter & Gamble would deliver directly to the stores. We had enough volume to where we could even circumvent having to pay P.A. Menard to bring in merchandise. We could handle a whole truck ourselves. And after we opened our store in Metairie in 1961, I believe it was, after we had opened our store there, we certainly had enough room. My dad put a little warehouse in that area, up in that store to store merchandise. So we did all of our own purchasing. So that has changed. Now there are fewer and fewer warehouses from which we can buy groceries from. So we are pretty much married to one or two suppliers, whereas before we had an unlimited amount of suppliers. Anyone that would sell to independents would get our business.
How has that changed the running of a store?
It's actually made some things more efficient. What we give up is the variety that customers wanted. If Mrs. Jones wanted a particular item that the warehouse wouldn't carry because the movement wasn't there, Zuppardo's and even Durignac's, I know we were two stores that we would get whatever our customers asked us for because we valued their business. Today, it's like, well, if you don't use one of the 16 brands that I've got, we don't need you to go shop someplace else. That's that Walmart mentality. This is what I have, buy it or go someplace else. We never had that mentality. We still don't today. However, we have less access to that unusual flavor of salad dressing that someone might like. Green Goddess is one of them. I still get requests for, after all these years. Seven Seas used to make a Green Goddess dressing that has since gone away. And gosh, Zatarain's Chow Chow. Those type of things that you can't get.
So even a brand like Zatarain's, which we identified very closely with New Orleans, is controlled by the system, right?
Yes, and it's also owned by McCormick. That's the difference in today's world.
Yeah, that I did not know. What's the most exciting or interesting thing you ever remember, either at the old location or the new location?
Gosh, I grew up in both stores. I can remember receiving my first tip bagging groceries. I can remember receiving my first quarter as a tip. That was big, because if you got a penny or two pennies for bagging someone's groceries and bringing them to their car, that was a lot. But one guy gave me a quarter. I was so excited that I got the quarter that I just jumped up and down, and the buggy rolled into Gentilly Boulevard and hit a car and cost my daddy like $15. Well, needless to say, that had to come out of my hide. So, but I was thrilled that I got my quarter. It was worth every second of it. I got chewed out pretty good. So that was one of my stories for Gentilly. Veterans was, when we first moved out here, Veterans Highway, it was one lane each direction. It was a two-lane road on the same side of the street that we're located today. There wasn't the four lanes with the divided canal. Everything was on one side of the canal. One of my earliest recollections is that I was a young teenager, and one of the cashiers was in a warehouse, and I heard a screaming, and I ran upstairs, and there was a snake in the warehouse. And that was not unusual, because it was the woods. There was nothing behind the store. There was nothing across the street from the store. And, you know, on a slow day, our biggest thrill was watching the fire department put out brush fires on Veterans, where my competitor is today, or where people's gas stations and houses are today. That was all just, in the summertime, it was someone threw a match down or something. It was a brush fire for quite some time. So it's come a long way.
Life in the country.
There you go. It was.
Are you any memorable old employees of the store?
Oh my gosh, I have been blessed that I have seen hundreds of people pass through our doors. A lot we don't consider employees, we considered family, because you work with them 7 days a week. You're in the store all the time. The grocery business was never a glamorous business, but you know, if you had the hard work and you worked for a good company, and thank God my parents did a good job in making everyone feel as part of the family. So I had a lot of close connections with a lot of people. And I had my hero when I was growing up and bagging groceries was Howard Vincent. He was a black man, big, tall, good-looking fella, who had every customer. I don't know what Howard did, but I heard during the war he would connive to get them extra butter or extra sugar, even if they forgot their stamps. You know, because in the old days, you had to have a stamp to get your sugar. You had to have a stamp to get your butter. Howard always had extra stamps. Where he got them from, I don't know. I don't know if my uncle would give them to him so that he could give them to the right people. I don't know what happened. But in those days, Howard was king. And he made more money on some days than the managers of the store did, because everyone wanted Howard to bag their groceries because Howard would give him that extra sugar stamp. Long after the war, people still came in the store and asked for Howard. That and when Howard retired, I was at the store when Howard retired. He would come every day and just come visit every day and spend an hour or so just telling everybody hello. Great person, someone you really love being around and knowing, and there's hundreds of colorful characters, but he came to my mind first when you asked me.
Yeah, a different age in
oh
the world.
Yes.
Let's see.
Okay. I used to call her Aunt Faye. Faye is in an assisted living facility today, doing okay. A little Alzheimer's. Her husband, Mike Zuppardo, was a cousin to my father. He was in the clothing business, but had some good managerial skills. He wound up, my father was in the Louisiana Retail Food Dealers Association. When the opening for the director came up, my dad recommended his cousin to take that job, and he did. And him and Faye ran the company together. That's her connection to the food business. But her connection to food goes way back, further than that, to the St. Joseph altars, where my Aunt Faye would get my mom, my Aunt Frances, my grandmas, everyone in the family geared to helping set up the St. Joseph altar every year for the city of New Orleans. It used to be at St. Joseph's Church on Tulane and Galvez, and right up in that area. And then it moved to Piazza d'Italia in downtown New Orleans. But she did that for many, many years. We used to do a lot of the prep work for that at the grocery store. For instance, we'd get Sunrise Bakery, which was Sunrise French Bread, which is now owned, the label is now owned by Leidenheimer. Although they still make it, they make it only in the plastic. Well, the people that own Sunrise Bakery would donate the bread every year. And it was, I want to say, 5,000 small pieces of bread. It was no bigger than a hamburger bun. But we'd bag the bread with a lucky bean, a St. Joseph's Day prayer, and gosh, I think we might even put a medal in there or something, twisted it up, and we'd have all of these wonderful Italian ladies in the back of the store. We set up the back of the store and have them bagging bread. My dad did that operation for years, and we'd have our truck there. So as they finished it, we'd have two or three employees helping move the stuff as the ladies did it. It was an assembly line to rival Detroit with the automobile making, the way they did it. It was awesome. And that was fun every year. And then I inherited that job from my dad. He goes, okay, you handle them. I had enough of them. And it was a joy to do so. They did a great job. And my Aunt Faye coordinated that part of it, but she coordinated the whole altar too.
Yeah. I've seen her in news pictures with Peter Compagno.
Correct. Peter was also one of the people. He was also one of the directors that did the St. Joseph altar for St. Joseph's Church for many, many years.
Is he somebody that would have worked with y'all in the food business at all? Or?
You know, I don't know what Peter Compagno did. I knew him, but I was too young to know what he did for a living. It didn't matter to me. He was always a nice guy.
Yeah, I was wondering if it was a food connection or a St. Rosalie connection.
You know, I would have to think it was more St. Rosalie than food. I don't recall him being in the food business.
Yeah. Who operates Zuppardo's today?
Well, our fourth generation is there. I retired in January. I have my two children have taken over my portion of the business. I sold it to them about 2 years ago. And so now I have my two children there. My brother is still very much involved. Tony Zuppardo's son, Peter, my first cousin, is also one of the partners in the business.
So still all in the family.
All in the family, yes.
How big is the store now today?
Our store today, it's a single store. It's only a 20,000 square foot sales area, not even quite 20,000, but does quite well, and we're very blessed. And our volume is coveted by many big chains.
You talked a little bit about the Katrina. What was it like to come back to the store in Gentilly after the storm?
Well, let me put it like this. Gentilly was sad. Gentilly was, oh my God, what are we going to do? But for 3 weeks, there was nothing. You couldn't even get to the store. So, I mean, I was fortunate enough to do it a good connection with the police and fire department out here in Metairie, and they would actually take me down to go look. And it just brought you to tears when you saw it. But the whole city brought you to tears. It wasn't just our misfortune. It was everyone's misfortune. So my stories are minuscule compared to the numbers and some things that people lost. We were able to salvage something. At least the ground underneath it was good. But, you know, that other than that, no. But we were concentrating, at least I was, after Katrina. I had gone to, I have a place in Covington, Louisiana, a little horse farm over there. And my family, my immediate family, went there. My brother went to Houma, Louisiana, and my cousin wound up in Houston. When I got back to the store like 2 days later, we were able to get in the store. We got a pass to get through the causeway and get back to the city through one of the councilmen here in town. And when we got to the store, I said, listen, y'all can have the store. Just get me back there. I'll get you whatever you need. I got milk. I got bread. I got water. I've got all of these supplies that we bought prior to. And then when they started the mandatory evacuation, all of this food was there. So I knew what I had. So I had a resource that I knew the parish needed, and they brought me in. And I gave this, actually, they emptied the store. But I said, you get me in, and I will give you whatever you need. And sure enough, they did. And we hauled stuff off of there as fast as we could, as much as we could, and wound up, you know, everyone knows the horror stories with Katrina and the non-responsiveness of the federal government and the ability to get food in and out. We had the food. We the police department, the fire department, they all depended on us to get food. And I can't tell you how many people that were stranded that they would come on a regular basis and come to the store. There was no registers. There was nothing. Take what you need, just you can't have, as long as you're not taking liquor, cigarettes, or beer, I know that you're legit. So our doors were opened, and we were pretty much, it was pretty much gone in, oh, maybe 6 weeks.
Yeah.
The store was emptied, yeah, but worked out good. Thank God we were able to do it.
Yeah, it was a long time before customers would have returned to that area, too.
Well, you know, my first thought was, oh my God, this is never going to be the same. I had been planning a European vacation, which I'd owed myself for like 20 years, and told my wife when I walked into the store after the first day, I said, now's a good time. We can go to Europe. We got 30 days. This city is never going to get back on its feet for the next 30 days. So we started thinking of that. And so actually she was planning a little vacation as quickly as she could, and slowly but surely employees would come to the store and say, hey, what are we going to do? And then it hit me, you know, this isn't just about Roy Zuppardo and him taking a vacation or his family taking off for a few days. There's families out here that are depending on us to get this thing back open and operating. And that, more than anything, the look in my employee's face, like, give me some direction, gave me the strength to say, hey, you know what? Let's tighten that belt and let's get to work and let's get this thing back up and running. We opened again September 19th. We were the first grocery store to reopen in Metairie after Katrina. And it paid off immensely in just the gratification of knowing that I helped bring people back to the city. Because I heard so many times people would call us and say, are y'all open? Because I'm not coming back unless I can get groceries, you know? And gosh, that was just so great. And to hear people thank you for being open, even though we didn't have all of it, because my store was empty, I had to start all over again. We didn't have everything, but we had a lot of everything. I had a lot of products, that, enough to get you through, and people were thrilled, and we were thrilled to be able to serve them.
Yeah, and things definitely were scarce in those days.
Yes.
Yeah. Check my time. I'm going to stop and restart this. Let's see, I need to pause this first. God, it paused itself.
Hope it didn't miss too much.
Well, this is still at least getting our audio, so I'm going to pause. Let's see. We're recording, and I'm going to give myself another couple of clicks. clicks to synchronize, and we are good for another 20 minutes.
All right.
That's great stuff on Katrina.
Yeah. Katrina was it was an event that will never happen again.
We hope not.
Yeah, hopefully.
Yeah. I actually saw a bit of an independent film where you were interviewed for on the independent food. And can you tell a little bit about, you know, the independent groceries and how you see them fitting in the future in the city? Or?
Well, you know, we're becoming dinosaurs. There's not that many of us left. And eventually, it's going to all be the Walmarts and the big chains. There'll always be a niche, I believe, for the Zuppardo family, especially in this market where you've got almost 100 years of service and people who know you and goodwill built up. So I believe that for at least the next generation will be around. I do feel that the smaller independents are going to go by the wayside eventually. I hate to see that coming, but things have cycles. I mean, we've seen it before where the independents went away and then the chains came in, and then the chains did such a bad job and people were not happy with the selection, the variety, the price, and then someone would open up and he'd do good, and then he'd open up another one, and then sure enough other people would come in. So it, for the next 20 years, I think it's going to be mostly a chain market, but the chains will mess up because theirs is a profit-driven program. And if they can make more money by selling four brands of salad dressing instead of 117, they're going to sell four brands of salad dressing. They don't care if they're the only ones in town whether you buy it there or not, because you're going to go to another one of their stores.
It kind of brings to mind the sort of the rise and fall of Schwegman's almost.
Schwegman was a completely different. His fall was not due to. It was just done. It was due to, I think, more poor management decisions than it was anything else. His pricing program drove us nuts for many, many years. And the Schwegman family and the Zuppardo family were friends for many years. So he shared with us what he did. So it was almost like, okay, here's my poker hand, but I got a full house. You can't beat me anyway. So I'll show it to you. And, you know, my uncle and John Schwegman Sr. had a good relationship. And John Jr. and I don't know if he's Jr., but John Schwegman and I had a good relationship. Served on some committees together. We served on the food bank board. We served on Louisiana retailers board and all that sort of stuff together. So good family, very community oriented. We lost a good, we haven't lost them, but a company that was very civic minded was Schwegman.
I've heard a lot of people say that, how much they miss Schwegman's. And being able, somebody was talking about being able to get a beer.
Well, you can still get a beer at Zuppardo's as you're shopping. You can stop at our snack bar and pick up a beer and go shopping in the grocery store. I have a friend of mine who's a sheriff in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, which is a dry county, or was a dry county at that time. When he first came down here and came in the store and saw this guy drinking beer in a grocery store, he goes, man, I'd have to arrest him if I was in Murfreesboro. Then I took him to Bourbon Street. I said, now what would you do? He said, I'd have to arrest everybody here on Bourbon Street. But things were different. Yeah, that was what, I still hear that story from a lot of people from out of town. I can't believe you can go in a grocery store and drink beer while you're shopping and drink wine while you're shopping. Yeah, you can do that. And Schwegman's in Gentilly had a bar room attached to the grocery store.
I think that's what I was thinking of.
Yes. Yeah. So when you went into Schwegman's, there was actually a door where you could go into the bar if you were over 18. I believe it was 18 at the time, and get something to drink and go do your shop.
Make some groceries.
Or when Mom was shopping, Dad was in a bar. And he got credit for time shopping.
Let's talk a little bit about, where are my questions on Italian? Here they are. What foods at the store would you identify with the Italian traditions in New Orleans? I mean, I'm thinking like cucuzza or something like that.
What is that?
Cucuza.
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 Yes. Yeah. Okay. And it's spelled Cucuza. C-U-C-U-Z-Z-A.
Yeah.
We grow that ourselves. 90% of the Cucuza that we sold prior to, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, prior to Katrina, was stuff that my father grew or that my brother or myself grew in our backyards. And because we, you know, we still have this desire to grow stuff. This is the first couple of years, well, maybe since Katrina, is the first time I haven't had a garden in my backyard. My house is sitting on two lots. One of them used to be a farm. Before I built this house, this whole thing was fruit trees and Cucuza vines and basil and, oh gosh, all that. I think it's just in Italians. We got to have tomatoes. You got to have bell peppers. You got to have eggplant. Everybody's got to have that. But then we grew Cucuza and a lot of different things. The thing that, one of the foods that I think, our Italian sausage is second to none. Maybe it's because it's what I'm used to, but I hear that from several people, Italians and non-Italians. Oh, y'all got the best Italian sausage. So we do sell a lot of Italian sausage. So I think that's strictly a New Orleans Italian sort of thing, and everyone's proud of their sausage, I'm sure. A good person should be. If he's not, he needs to find another career. But we are proud of that. I got to say one thing, that in 1961, I believe, when we opened the store, my father put a kitchen at the veteran store. Now, it wasn't much of a kitchen, but it was a small little kitchen. And his idea was, you know what, I'll get my wife to come in. She'll make meatballs, stuffed artichokes, meatballs and spaghetti, stuffed artichokes, stuff that she knows how to do, and we can make a few bucks selling that sort of cooked food. Well, that was 40 years ahead of its time, because today that kitchen produces thousands of meals a week. You know, for a small grocery store like ours, you can go buy, there's at least 17 or 18 different types of soup on a daily basis, at least 12 to 15 different entrees served on a daily basis, all types of salads, some Italian, some not. You know, we still got the Italian olive salad. We've got, gosh, Italian food, not a whole lot. Today, the tastes have changed, although pasta with garlic and shrimp is as good as any. We do make a lot of things with a little Italian flair to it, but mostly to accommodate American tastes today. But we do a lot of cooking out of the kitchen, and I was proud. I even thought of that today when my dad at the store visited with him earlier today, and I even thanked. I said, "Man, that was great. How did you know to put a kitchen in?" He said, "I thought we could use it." You know, so that's what we did. So
that's great. That's great. The holiday shopping. What distinguishes, I mean, we know at groceries, that holiday is a big deal. What distinguishes New Orleans, and is there an Italian angle to that?
I don't know if it's so much an Italian angle, but I'd have to claim it is because we're so food-oriented. How many grocery stores can you go in and buy oyster dressing? You know, I mean, and homemade oyster dressing. Duranax does one. We do a great one. Of course, it's my recipe that I got from my mom, so it's a Sicilian recipe, as are 90% of the recipes of the food that we have come from my mom and her mom and her mom. So, you know, we've got that Sicilian flair in there. So the oyster dressing we make a melaton dressing, which is a French item, but it lends itself to, it's just like Cucuza, a melaton Cucuza. If you cut them and cube them and cook them the same way, you can hardly tell a difference between Cucuza and a melaton. They're both kind of bland vegetables, and they're both the same color, and they both have about the same water content and texture. So it could easily have been a Cucuza as opposed to a melaton dressing. So we knew how to do it, so we did it. I mean, you know, my mother said, "This is how I make my melaton dressing. Just pretend like it's Cucuza." Yeah, and today it's not just Italians. Langenstein's does cooking like that. So does, I know Duranax does. Rouse's even makes it now, and they're Cajun. So, you know, everybody has their own way of doing it. So it's not just Italian, but.
Define your definition of Italian Creole.
Wow. hard to make it's hard for me to define it as such. I will say this, being a cook myself and knowing what Creole cooking is and knowing the basis of it and how to do it, I think the Italian part of it adds a little more to it. You know, instead of just the holy trinity of the bell peppers, the onions, and the celery, throw in the garlic. Throw in the olive oil. Don't saute it in butter because that's too fat, and unless you use the olive oil, the flavor is just as good. We come up with a different set of spices, the basil, the oregano, the spices that add a little something to it that the French never had access to. So to say Italian Creole, yeah, people say that, but it's just taking what works here and adding something to it and experimenting with it and saying, hey, you know what, that works too. Let's continue to do that. So the recipe comes from just celery, onions, and bell pepper to celery, onions, bell pepper, garlic. And instead of just salt and pepper, we're going to throw in some oregano. And it's just, and today, cooking is off the charts. I think people are doing things today that I never imagined would be done in combinations that today it's a science. It's not just trial and error. I think they know what they're doing before they start, you know?
Imagine that, huh? Not to be gun shy about this, but I'm going to start with it.
You're asking some tough questions, though.
Well, I try. And now my camera is saying it's overheating, but I'm going to just keep on going until it quits. And I'll say, oh, it's going? Yeah, I'll start. That going? And I'm going to click. And let's talk a little bit more about Italian food.
Okay.
If there's a place or number of places that you would identify with defining Italian New Orleans,
first place comes to mind is Tony Angelo's restaurant. Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, restaurants? That kind of thing. Restaurants, groceries.
Okay. Yes. Tony Angelo's restaurant, Sicilian. I'm Sicilian. So I relate to that better than I do Andrea's, which would be more of a northern Italian sort of place. Grocery stores that reek Italian. Gosh, I've been in so many of them. The best ones in New Orleans or New York.
Here,
I've been to some great ones.
If Zuppardo was closed for some reason,
okay,
and you had to pick up, I don't know, something essential.
Yes, like Milanesa for St. Joseph's Day. Central Grocery would probably get more of my business than any place else, simply because it's on the lines of the New York style Italian grocery stores. Nice amount of cheeses, all Italian stuff. You can get Milanesa there. You can get the baccalà there that you can't buy anywhere else. You can get, St. Lucie's Day was a big day for Italians, and we couldn't eat bread. I did break my St. Lucie's Day this year. I didn't think of it in time. But we used to have to eat these horrible chicharrones, I think it was called. It was a wheat ball, and you couldn't have bread, but this was what we ate instead of bread. And it was just, I hated St. Lucie's Day when I was a young kid because I couldn't have bread, I couldn't have potato chips, I couldn't have all of the good stuff. I could only eat these wheat balls twice, you know? Oh, God, they were horrid. And you could put milk and sugar on them, and they still were terrible. But no, Central Grocery, Progress Grocery Store, same, you know, those two in the French Quarter are probably the first two places I think of when you think Italian.
In your mind, either historically, today, or whichever, when you think about the French market, what do you think?
Well, I used to go to the French market with my dad quite a bit. We'd go in the mornings, he'd wake me up before the sun got up, and we'd go, and we lived in Gentilly, so it was a 5-minute drive. And we'd go, and there'd be guys there with truckloads of cauliflower or watermelons or tomatoes or corn, And we'd go through the French market every day, and he'd say, okay, I like that. Send me, you know, come meet me at the store. Here's my address. Or if they knew him already, come send me 20 of those. And, you know, that was fun. I enjoyed that. And my uncle used to, my dad used to handle the produce part of the business, and my uncle used to handle the meat part. So I have stories. I went with my uncle a couple of times to cut a hay packing company, which is right across the street from where the Superdome is today. I think it might be one of those office buildings. It used to be Cudahy Meatpacking Company. And he'd go in there and he'd look at, it was just this huge, huge warehouse of beef that was hanging up. And he'd walk by and he'd say, okay, give me that piece, give me that piece, give me that piece. He'd tag the ones he wanted. And he had a good relationship with the guy. So the guy would give him what he asked for. He wouldn't say, just give me five hindquarters and five fronts. He'd go pick them out himself because he knew what he wanted. And my dad did the same with the vegetables. Although I might, that there was a little more skill involved in picking the meat than, I mean, I can tell you what a pretty tomato looked like, as you could, but you had to see beyond the fat, what was underneath that fat, to know what was in that meat. And my uncle did have that ability to pick it out.
And that was when you were a little kid.
Oh, yeah. I was a teenager.
That have been the early 60s?
Yes.
Yeah.
I was born in 1951.
Yeah. Poydras Street changed a lot in that.
Poydras Street has changed, yes. You noticed. There wasn't a Superdome down there when we went.
Tell me a little bit about Tony Angelo.
What a delightful person. I thought of him because I've been dying to go there. I had a stomach issue and haven't had good Sicilian food in a while, and now that I'm feeling good again, I'm ready to go chow down on some pig's feet and pork knuckles and pasta with crab and guguzza and caponata and whatever he's got cooking today. I know it's going to be good. He does a great job, and it's Sicilian style. It really is. It's the way my mom's mom used to cook. So if you want true Sicilian, he's the place to go here in the city.
You're too young to remember Solari's, aren't you?
Knew of them, but yes, no. Did not go there.
I'm getting to my big wrap-up question.
Okay.
How do you think people view the Italian contributions to New Orleans today?
I think it got lost in the mix. I think there's so much that we did do for the city culturally, but you know, I'm sure a lot of different groups feel that way. But I do think that New Orleans is New Orleans, and the culture is part of that culture. I think we're a big part of it. I really do. And yes, I do think that as we get older, people forget. I mean, take my family. I am second generation. My dad was conceived in Italy, born in America, so I'm second generation American. My kids, although they know they're Italian, although they do love their Italian heritage, I spend a lot of time instilling that in them. Will they do that to their generation? I think it's slipping away, and I think I did a better job of instilling that importance of our ancestry in my kids than most people do in their kids today. So I believe everybody is American today, and where you came from was, I mean, I can remember asking everyone, where are you from? Or where's your family from? Today, it's a question I like to ask, but a lot of people, well, they don't really have a...
Let's say, I'm from West Wego.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Wagamon.
And do you think, historically, when you were a kid, how did people perceive Italians when you were a kid?
Can I just give me a second? I'm sorry.
Not a problem.
Hey, we're filming in here, so sorry.
Okay.
It's just coming in.
Not a problem. We're good.
Okay. I'm sorry. Go ahead and ask your question.
I'm going to ask this one first. When you were a kid, how did you think, the 60s, early 60s, late 50s, how was growing up in an Italian family? How do you think in New Orleans?
It was different. I mean, I had my best friend was Cuban, and he lived a couple of doors down, and his culture was completely different than ours. there were a lot of, I could see them as a kid. Well, gee, why do y'all do that? And how come you don't do it this way? I didn't experience the discriminatory things that a lot of Italians did. And you can tell, even in my family, cousins marrying cousins and that sort of stuff, because we were such a tight-knit group, as were a lot of groups that come to New Orleans or wherever. The Vietnamese is a good example. They started off the same way. Everybody working together and helping everyone get better. The Italians did that. You know, the Vietnamese did that. We got together and said, okay, listen, Joe needs help. Let's go help him. You know, and there was never any, okay, well, you know, somebody might, but everybody did it. And so that closeness in the Italian society, whether it was forced on us through other people not wanting to associate with us for whatever reason there might have been, remains unclear to me today. I never did feel that, and certainly don't feel it today. But yes, that was one of the reasons that we stayed so close, and my family is so close today, is because we did everything as a group.
Great, great. I feel like I've missed like half my questions, but is there anything you want to, as a postscript, to you'd like to add? Anything for posterity, since this will be in an archive?
Well, I appreciate that opportunity. You know, I love the city of New Orleans. I would never think of leaving it. I love the food industry. I am now chair of the board of Second Harvest Food Bank. Proud to say that we're one of the better organizations in the state of Louisiana. We serve over 23 parishes. So food has always been a part of my life, and New Orleans has got a place in my heart that can never be taken away. I'm a Gentilly boy. I will always be a Gentilly boy. Even though my store isn't in Gentilly anymore, I still feel a sense of pride when I go down to Gentilly.
Great. Thank you very much.
Okay, you're welcome.
We've been recording with Roy Zuppardo. Rosario Zuppardo, if you really want to be official. And it is in the afternoon of July 14th, 2010.
And Second Harvest now is a first responder for the state of Louisiana.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
You know, when the BP oil spill started,
uh-huh.
We were the first group there. We got a truck out that day. A truckload of water was sent out as soon as within 2 hours of the oil coming out of the ground when we heard about it. Oh, my God, there's a disaster. And
you're right there.
We were right there. Boom.
Yeah.
Next day, delivery.
That's incredible.
And then when Dixie donated a whole truckload of food, Zatarain's did a whole truckload of food. So we got that. And they did it through us. Hey, what do you need? This is what we need. Send it, you know. So, and for Hurricane Katrina, we learned a lot. We got our act together. And so for the next hurricane, Gustav, we were right there.
Yeah.
So we are now, the food bank is, it's still gives me a touch with food, which probably is why I like it so much. Because now I know I'm still helping people eat dinner, you know.
Yeah.
I've been serving dinner for all my life, and now I'm still putting food on the table for people.